Good morning. I'm State Senator Kevin Parker, Chairman of the Energy and Telecommunications Committee. This is our, first meeting. Well, actually, our last meeting in February. How about that? I'm trying to count the meetings. I don't even know what meeting we are on. But I want to thank everybody for taking time to be here. Very exciting that we have Justin Driscoll, the President of the New York Power Authority, and he has a presentation he's going to present to the committee after our short agenda. We have about 8 bills that we're going to quickly go through. I'm looking forward to a lively conversation about the future of energy in the state of New York. Let's begin.
Good morning, everyone. The first bill we have is Senate Bill 314 by Senator Salazar, an act directing the New York State Research and Development Authority to establish a Riot Clean Rebate Program.
Questions, comments, concerns? Yes.
Yes, so Chairman, this is a rebate program that's up to $1,100 for an e-bike. I think if we're trying, my concern is that if we're really trying to be greener, and if you look at the entire carbon footprint and some of the rare earth metals that are included in these things, including their batteries, we really would be better incentivizing people to go with a traditional bike that just has pedals. And I say that as a policymaker, but also as a biased cyclist here
okay.
as well.
Okay. Noted. Any other questions, comments, concerns? All right. I have a motion to move the bill by Senator Mannion, seconded by Senator Gonzalez. Any no votes? Any without recs?
No vote.
No, Senator Walczak. We have enough to send it? So the bill goes to third reading. Next.
The next bill we have is Senate Bill 405 by Senator Parker, an act to amend the public service law in relation to utility intervener reimbursement and to amend the state finance law in relation to establishing an utility intervener account program.
Questions, comments, concerns? A motion to move the bill by Senator Gonzalez, second by Senator Mannion. Any no votes? Any without rec?
Yes, without rec.
Okay.
No.
No. Okay. One without rec. The bill is referred to the Finance Committee. Next bill.
The third bill we have is Senate Bill 489 by Senator Carmody, an act to amend the Public Authorities Law in relation to requiring the New York State Energy and Research Development Authority to develop a comprehensive electric vehicle fast charging station implementation plan.
As many of you know that we're going to have to replace about 2.5 million vehicles across the state of New York. Having fast charging stations is going to be a critical part of that, particularly to alleviate a lot of the range anxiety that motorists currently have about getting electric vehicles. This bill is like an important step towards that process, and so we're bringing it through the committee. Any questions, comments, concerns?
I have a concern, yeah. Chairman. From my experience and those who I know that drive EVs, mm-hmm. Generally charge them at home, use the charging stations pretty rarely in their regular course of business. Mm-hmm. And I've asked the president of NYSERDA a number of times what electrical upgrades are going to be required for each home. Even, as the Research and Development Authority asked for some research on, and over the last of the past few years, asked for some research on, how many homes have 100 amp service or less mm-hmm. in the state of New York? How many have 200 amp service or less in the state of New York? I think that would be important. From what I've seen from mm-hmm. consumer data, and when we're talking about really integrating electric vehicles in people's lives, I think that is probably more important than considering where on our interstate highways to put fast charging mm-hmm. stations. So I would just offer that up for the committee's consideration.
Yeah, I would say that you're making a lot of really good important points. I think that it's not an either-or proposition, that in fact we need to do both. And I think that there is an ability to, in fact, look at both of those issues. But folks who travel up here, including a number of legislators who I've talked to, who have EVs that come to the Capitol, are really concerned about the ability to get charging, even in the Capitol. we haven't gotten enough there. So both need to be done. Let's move this bill and then move on to looking at some of the questions that you have. I mean, if you're interested in looking at that, maybe you should put a study bill in, then we'll, you know, bring it through the committee.
Okay.
Right. And may I?
No. Sorry, only one. No, just okay.
No, and I'm in favor of this bill with Senator Comrie, and I really think it's so important. In other words, we're doing any kind of research and development and something like that, so this is something important for our future, so I look forward to this. But again, just like what my colleague was saying, we just need to make sure that we add as much into that as right. possible.
Absolutely. Any other questions, comments, concerns? Uh-huh.
Thank you, Chair. As a proud owner of a Chevy Volt, which gets me about 300 miles on a 7-gallon tank or an 8-gallon tank and about 50 miles of charge. I purchased it in 2018. I'm happy to see this, and honestly, I thought, you know, we would see more charging stations over the course of that time that I had have owned the vehicle. So I do use the charging stations downstairs, and they're very convenient and easy to use, and I appreciate that. I will say that as part of the study, the different types of chargers, not just the different levels, mm-hmm. but for the different vehicles is important because some investment has occurred and people get very frustrated when they pull up and it's a Tesla charger and they don't have a Tesla vehicle.
Right, okay.
With that, I make a motion to move.
Thank you very much. Bill is being moved by Senator Mangan and seconded by Senator Gonzalez. Thank you. Next bill?
The next bill we have up is Senate
bill. I'm sorry. The last bill is going to third reading.
The next bill we have up is Senate Bill 2585-8 by Senator Parker, an act to amend the public service law in relation to establishing a zero emission energy system.
Questions, comments, concerns? Motion to move by Senator Mann, second by Senator Walter. Any no votes? Any without recs? That bill is moved to the Finance Committee. Next bill.
The next bill we have is the fifth bill, Senate Bill 2966 by Senator Kavanaugh, an act to amend the Energy Law, the Environmental Conservation Law, the Public Authorities Law, and the General Municipal Law in relation to requiring certain watercraft, aircraft, and trains to be zero emission, and to amend the public authorities law in relation to requiring NYSERDA to conduct certain studies and requiring certain monetary incentives to clean energy vehicles.
Mm-hmm. So in addition to the 2.5 million vehicles on the roads, obviously, you know, we also need to be looking at trains, aircraft, watercraft. This bill begins the process again of trying to develop a study and a plan, and then also put some monetary resources towards implementing that. And so, any questions, comments, concerns?
Yes, I do.
Yes.
Thank you, Chairman. Uh-huh. I look at this and I am a no vote on this because we need to look forward what's going on right now mm-hmm. with future of renewable energy for our families and their homes and do whatever we have to do with mm-hmm. that. But you know what, this is, yes, it's important, but I just think that we need to really concentrate 110% on our residents of New York State.
Mm-hmm. Senator Walter?
Chairman, just so I'm reading this right, this is electric airplanes is what we want the New York State Energy Research and Development Authority to study?
Zero emissions, it doesn't necessarily have to be electric.
Okay. So my main concern, and not to pick on uh-huh. NYSERDA, which I'm capable of doing, but to take tax money and systems benefit charges out of people's bills and put that towards this study, I think is pretty out of touch with the direction that we need to go. And I think the direction that you've been leading this committee in, frankly. So I'm not going to be supporting it to discharge from this committee. I think this bill is far from being ready to go for a full vote and probably deserves its own public hearing. I mean, I'll spare everyone in the room the time with going through all of the issues with this. I'm going to vote no, and would ask for your consideration to also just leave it in committee at this time.
Okay. No, this is definitely something that we should be having a conversation about. Maybe Senator Kavanaugh will consider a public hearing on that. I certainly will bring that to his attention. I think the conversation about what we need to do in the context of the CLCPA is a comprehensive idea, right? And so it is not just commercial buildings and residential buildings. Again, as we talked about earlier, you know, 2.5 million vehicles on the roads, we have vehicles on waterways, we have trains, we have aircraft that all need to be decarbonized, right? And so, again, this bill fits with perfectly within the CLCPA, one of the steps that we need to take. I don't think that dealing with buildings, residential and commercial buildings, or dealing with watercraft, trains, and aircraft is, again, a dichotomy. I think that all of those things need to be done. And they frankly need to be done simultaneously. We can walk and chew gum at the same time. The other thing is that this is actually another great economic opportunity, because as we start transitioning into zero emission vehicles, those zero emission vehicles and those subsequent technologies have to be created and manufactured somewhere. We're also trying to position the state of New York to be a hub for the development of a clean energy economy. And so I think that, again, this legislation is in step with that and brings us towards it, but certainly I respect the views of my colleagues. Do I have a motion to move the bill? I do, from Senator Mannion, second by Senator Gonzalez. I know we have at least one no vote. So two no votes. This bill will refer to the Finance Committee. Next bill?
The next bill we have is Senate Bill 2988 by Senator Harkin, an act to amend the public service law in relation to requiring barring trimming from maintenance of utility poles.
Yeah, this seems like kind of like, you know, odd if I didn't kind of know the issue, but the deterioration of energy, you know, these poles, utility poles, is a big deal. And so the more that you can maintain them, the more resilient they are during storms and crisis incidences. And so this bill is a step towards addressing some of that. Any other questions, comments, concerns about it? Do I have a motion to move the bill? Senator Mannion, second by Senator Gonzalez. Any no votes without rec?
I'm a no vote.
We have two no votes, right? This bill is referred to third reading. Next.
The next bill we have is Senate Bill 4304 by Senator Parker, an act to amend the public service law and the public authorities law in relation to credit for electricity generated by customer generators subject to net energy metering.
Questions, comments, concerns? Motion to move the bill, Senator Gonzalez, second by Senator Mannion. Any without recs or no votes?
No.
I'm sorry, you have used all your no's already, so you're automatically, I'm just joking. We have one no.
No, well, no, I'm
okay. Okay, so one no vote. This bill will refer to third reading. Next.
The next bill we have is Senate Bill 4305 by Senator Parker, an act to amend the public service law in relation to requiring cellular telephone companies and third-party service providers to provide plans to public service to the Public Service Commission to make all cell towers 100% renewable energy powered by 2031.
Questions, comments, concerns about this? Yes.
You know, and again, guys, and please, Senator Parker, I appreciate you. I appreciate all that you've done, you know, with this, running this this committee. But mandates, New Yorkers deserve better than mandates. And this is something that is another mandate, and I'm a no vote.
Okay.
So if you could please explain to New Yorkers, but you know, why we do mandates? Why can't we transition to things when we're ready?
Well, they're ready. I mean, this is not technology that's being suggested in this bill that doesn't exist. This technology exists right now, and they can implement it. And it's not and when we talk about mandates, typically you're talking about mandates to your localities. This is a mandate on the companies, right? The municipalities don't have responsibilities over these. These towers are maintained by the companies. And so we're asking the companies to do it in a certain way, in the same way that any other thing that we ask companies to do that we think is in the best interest of our taxpayers. And so, I don't know if it's burdensome on the companies, but it certainly is in line with the CLCPA and the work that we need to do in terms of both, reducing carbon in the state and also, transitioning to a clean, just energy economy in the state. So, Any other questions, comments, concerns?
Thank you. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, Chairman, so they would have to be 100% carbon-free, no fossil fuels at the at any cell phone tower by 2025. Is that right?
Yes.
This bill is enacted?
No, by 2031.
No later than December, cell phone towers renewable, notwithstanding Section 5 of this chapter or any other law of the country, no later than December 31st, 2025 is what the bill text reads.
Okay.
At the end of the bill, sorry.
Look at the...
At the end of the paragraph.
Thanks. That's why they tell you read the whole bill, right? Right in the last line there. So I do have a...
The plan is by... By 2025?
The plan is...
And implementation by 2031.
So, I appreciate that this will at least allow for some feedback from New Yorkers that are concerned about fully electrifying towers that are currently supplied by natural gas or from backup generators. This bill was brought to my attention for concern from local EMS coordinators. Who their radio towers are actually supplied on cell phone towers. They contract with cell phone towers. They ensure that each one of those times they have a backup generator for that tower. Sometimes it's the primary if it's in a rural area that is running the tower. And they do that because they need to communicate with emergency services, and there's no other way to do it in some of the rural areas of New York State. Yeah. So.
Well, some of them, they should, one, talk to the sponsor and the chair of the committee, because they have not, as far as I know, no one has approached us about that. And then the second piece as relates to that is that this does not reduce or interfere with any redundancies that need to be done. And you can create redundancies that are zero emissions as well. Right, and so like again, this is not to change anything other than the way that we're doing it. Right, and so we're going from.
I'm sorry. What would those redundancies be, Chairman?
Because what you're talking about is a redundancy, right? You're talking about a backup generator, mm-hmm. And I'm saying you can do all of those things and still comply with the legislation. It doesn't stop it.
Plus the bill is more so of a plan. So it's not, it's more so of a study. It's to submit a plan to do so. So it's not permanently.
This is not happening today. Yeah. They have until 2025, right, to in fact develop a plan and then implement it by 2031. So we're not like 60 days from the enactment of the bill or 90 days from the enactment of the bill. We're saying, let's pass the legislation, let's do a study, let's have a plan in place, and let's start implementing this in a couple of years. The CLCPA is happening. We've already passed that. Like that bridge has already been crossed, right? So every other thing that we're doing now is about implementation. And so not doing this doesn't mean that it doesn't have to get done. It just means that at some other time, somebody else is gonna have to pass this legislation to get it done. Right, and then the question is whether you're scrambling to get it done, you know, in 2030, right? Like whether you know you're saying up front, we're clear that there's a number of things that need to be done. Let's start looking at these things. Let's start studying them and figure out how we get to a place. So if the EMS folks are really concerned, have them reach out to me. I'm happy to talk to them. I'm happy to work through them. But they also have 2 years to get a plan in place to figure out. How do they create reliability and redundancy and resilience into the process such that their concerns are addressed?
Yeah, we'll have them reach out for sure, Chair. Yeah. And I appreciate your continued open mind on on the way that we move forward, whether it's laws that have been enacted in the past, mm-hmm. and we're trying to determine the best way forward, or whether it's specifically on this bill.
Yeah,
thank you.
Any. Other questions, comments, concerns? A motion to move, Senator Manning, seconded by Senator Gonzalez. We have two no votes.
Yes.
Two no votes. The bill is going to be reported to third reading. And last bill.
The last bill we have is Senate Bill 4854 by Senator Barker, an act to require the New York State Energy Research and Development Authority to develop recommendations regarding the establishment of microgrids.
Questions, comments, concerns? Yeah.
A comment, this is a finely crafted piece of legislation.
Thank you, finally.
Please pass it.
I knew if I kept doing it. I'd like to thank the Academy.
Pass along to the sponsor that I think it's a good idea and I'll be supporting it. I won't even make a motion to move it.
Thank you very much.
Second that.
Thank you very much. The bill has been properly moved and seconded. Any no votes without Rex? This bill will be reported to third reading. Any questions, comments, concerns from the committee on anything that we've actually discussed today or anything that you want to discuss going forward? Senator Gonzalez?
No, but I do have to excuse myself.
Yes, ma'am.
I have my own committee meeting.
Yes.
In 3 minutes, so I'm going to hop over.
Which I'm a member of, and I will be there shortly.
I'll see you soon.
Yes, ma'am.
I appreciate it.
Yes, absolutely. Thank you. And again, as I mentioned earlier, we are joined by the president of the New York Power Authority, Justin Driscoll, and I'd like to turn over the meeting to him to give some brief opening remarks and a short presentation, and then followed by some questions from the committee.
Great. Well, thank you, Chairman Parker, members of the committee. It's great to be with you here today. We value greatly the partnership of the legislature at the New York Power Authority and at the New York State Canal Corporation, and we look forward, obviously, to continue to work closely with you in pursuing the state's objectives. I did have a couple of slides. Is there a clicker somewhere?
Do you have a clicker?
Yeah, I've got it right here. Oh, okay, sorry. You can do it. You can just move to the next slide, please. Great, thank you very much. So I just wanted to kind of set the table in terms of NYPA's operations. Basically, our activities can be put into three buckets. One is our generation capacity. This slide represents our generation portfolio and footprint. The other two are our transmission activities, and then finally our customer-related activities. So as you look at the map, you can see sort of the scale and the breadth of our footprint around the state. Starting in Western New York, our flagship power plant, the Niagara Power Project, is the third largest hydro facility in the nation, 2,700 megawatts of nameplate capacity. We're very proud of that facility. Of course, any member of this committee and any other member of the legislature, always welcome to come and see us and have a tour of Niagara or any of our other facilities. It's really a breathtaking project where we take water out of the Niagara River before it reaches Niagara Falls, and it runs over a mile to our plant where the water is stored and then dropped down through our generation turbines and then out onto the Niagara River on the other side of the falls. And one interesting footnote is we take less water in the summertime so that more water goes over the falls for tourism purposes. Mm-hmm. So our output is reduced somewhat in the summertime to accommodate tourism in Western New York. Our other major hydro facility is an interesting plant on the St. Lawrence River on the Canadian border that we share with Canada. 16 turbines operated by the Power Authority, 16 turbines operated by Canada, christened by Queen Elizabeth. We actually, interestingly enough, on this plant have a little border crossing down in the bowels of the plant that many of you may have seen between the U.S. and Canada. Welcome to have you come and see the operation of the St. Lawrence facility. And another interesting, won't go through them all, but another interesting facility is our Blenheim Gilboa storage, pump storage plant. There are very few pump storage facilities in the United States. This is a 1,100 megawatt pump storage facility. Basically, it's a big battery, water up on top, drop it down through the turbines into a pool down below, pump it back up at night or during optimal times, drop it back down again and generate electricity during optimal periods of time for optimal energy pricing. And it's relied on very heavily by the NYISO in terms of system reliability. So we're very proud of our Blenheim Gilboa pump storage facility as well. As we get down into the New York City area, we have the Flynn plant on Long Island that's under contract to LIPA that they rely on for their system resiliency. And in the city, we have 11 peaker units, 6 different sites around the city, and we also have a peaker facility in Brentwood and also a 500 megawatt plant in Astoria that's under contract to the city of New York, as is a lease that we have with Astoria 2, which is also a plant that is utilized by the city. So it's a really interesting generation portfolio. Gives you a sense again of the statewide footprint that we have at the Power Authority. So if you could turn to the next slide, please. So this gives you a sense of our transmission assets. We like to say that we're the backbone of the grid of the high voltage transmission system. You'll see the colored lines are all NYPA lines, either a partnership with the private sector or owned by NYPA. And then the gray lines are lines that are owned by other utilities. So you can see we really do have that east to west, north to south backbone of the system. We're the largest owner and operator of the transmission system, 1,400 circuit miles of high voltage transmission from 765 kV down to 230 kV. One thing I point out, on the right side are projects underway. We're leaning in very heavily, as you all know, in the upgrade and build out of our transmission system to accommodate the transmission of solar and wind upstate, whereas we all know a lot of renewable generation upstate in a reliance heavily on fossil generation downstate. Obviously, we need to move that renewable power down to the load centers around the state, and we're playing a leading role in building out the transmission system. One project in particular across the Canadian border that I'll highlight is our Smart Path Connect project. That project is interesting because it's designed to unbottle wind projects that have been located in the North Country that were having trouble getting some of that electricity out of the North Country down to where it's needed. So we're upgrading that line to accommodate and move more wind and solar from upstate down into central New York, and then as you can see down on NYPA lines down toward the New York City area as well. And Smart Path Connect will connect with our Smart Path line, no coincidence there. And Smart Path brings power from the North Country down to our major transmission facility in the Utica area at Marcy. And then in the New York City area, as you may know, there's a proceeding underway at the NYISO, where it's designed to upgrade the Long Island grid to accommodate all the offshore wind power that will be coming into Long Island and to New York City. And we're partnering with Transco there on a project called Propel, and that's designed to, again, upgrade the Long Island system, which doesn't have the same high voltage that we see around upstate, and build it out, upgrade it, and have power be able to flow from Long Island into the city, and then even at times off of Long Island, if too much electricity comes on the island from offshore wind, you have to get it off the island. And so we actually have a line, Y49 line, that goes from Westchester to Garden City that could be utilized to move, it's bi-directional, so it can be utilized to move power, even off Long Island and into Westchester and then onto the upstate grid if necessary for grid stability. So that's the transmission footprint. Big role there, leaning in heavily in the energy transition to move renewables around state. And then finally, if you could flip to the customer side. So we have three buckets of customers: governmental, economic development, and munis and co-ops. We serve all the government buildings in New York City, as well as all public entities in the city. So all the power of the subways is our power, provided by NYPA. All New York City buildings, NYCHA, World Trade Center, and really all OGS, all governmental buildings in the city get their power from NYPA, as does Westchester County. So those are our governmental customers. They get price certainty from us under contracts that we negotiate with them. Middle bucket, economic development. Those are customers primarily that are located near our big hydro facilities. They get low-cost hydro in exchange for job commitments and capital commitments. And then the final bucket is Recharge New York, which is a statewide program. Also economic development in nature, where they get one half hydro, one half market power, and they make job commitments, capital commitments, and we audit them every year to make sure they're staying true to the promises they make in exchange for our power. And then finally, interestingly, we serve 51 munis and co-ops around the state, all different shapes and sizes. Those are customers that are part of federal law and state law when we were formed. And these are communities that own their own wires. They get their power from the local utility, but they own the wires in their communities, and some of them may just have one bucket truck or two bucket trucks, but they're their own little utilities, and they get our lowest cost power. They get power at cost from the power authority, and we're actually helping them in other areas as well. We're helping them on cyber to make sure that you're up to speed on the latest on cyber, because some of these local utilities have been identified as potential vulnerabilities in the grid from a cyber perspective. So we're helping them kind of you know, pardon their system and give them the benefit of NYFA and other industry learning. And so if you could flip to the next slide, I just want to highlight one thing, which is a little pivot for us, but we're very proud of our work on the Rural Broadband Initiative in the governor's state of the state. She announced last year, Connect All, which is a $10 million pilot. We've rolled that out. We've actually put in operation broadband services to three customers. A couple of them are our muni customers. But interestingly, when we developed a communication system on our transmission network, and we bought excess fiber, and so we were able to tap into our excess fiber and serve what they call a middle mile role. So we're taking fiber from our transmission system, bringing it to some local communities that don't have internet, and then we meet the ISP there, we meet the local provider there, they hook up the town. So we've actually hooked up Sherburne, which is a muni customer of ours. We're actually chasing about $300 million of federal money with ESD in the state to try to tap into some additional federal resources to build this out, not just NYPA, you know, broadband or NYPA transmission assets, but around the state. And we look to play a similar role in that middle mile role along with the utilities as well. But we're really proud of this Connect All because I think it demonstrates how the Power Authority can pivot and lean in to meet needs of the state. We've always been proud to be able to do big things. And this is a good example of us meeting a need here that, quite frankly, has gone too long unaddressed in our state. So I think there might be one final slide just to show you where the towns are. So that's our transmission line that has the excess fiber on it. And you see where we brought it to those towns. And we look to, like I said, particularly if we get that money from the federal government, build it out from there. So that's sort of NYPA in a nutshell.
If you get the federal money, how many towns would you be able to connect?
I think, we would go as far as $300 million would take us. I guess okay. That would be the way to describe it. But, you know, we probably look, I know there's a map already of all the areas that are underserved or unserved. And so we would look at, we'd probably go to unserved first.
Right,
then underserved, and try to get as much mileage out of those federal dollars as we can. But again, it was something that the legislature, thank you, was able to provide last year, giving us additional expanded authority to do fiber, to do this work. It was part, I think, of the state budget last year. So we went right to work with it. And so again, more to come on that. We hope to be able to really scale that up significantly along with ESD and we'll be chasing that federal money, as I said.
Let me ask another question. NYPA serves a bunch of city agencies. I didn't see many state agencies on that list, and I'm wondering why that was, particularly SUNY. Why isn't NYPA the provider?
A lot of the state entities have historically gotten their power from OGS, and we were only allowed to be the energy supplier. It's an interesting history. We were allowed to do energy supply for the downstate region only. Right. And the history of it is fascinating. When we were asked to take over the nuclear plants from Con Edison, we of course agreed to do that. The state wanted that to happen. Con Edison was struggling in 1974, I think it was. In exchange for that, we needed customers. We were going to own this nuclear asset, and we needed an off-taker. And part of the deal was, okay, you'll take the Con Edison governmental customers,
right,
and they'll be your NYPA customers. And so that was kind of the trade that took place back then. And so that's why it was limited. We did get expanded authority from the legislature a couple of years ago to serve other governmental entities outside the New York City region. We got a number of products that we're offering to the SUNYs and DOCs and OGSs and others as we sit here today trying to roll out new products and services for those customers.
Yeah, we should look at that here in the committee because I can't imagine that if OGS is just buying straight from the grid that we couldn't provide a cost savings on energy by having NYPA. Mm-hmm. It just doesn't, just counterintuitive to me that we have a state entity that produces energy and we don't sell it to state. We don't sell that commodity to ourselves.
But just so we're clear though, some of the power we provide to some of these entities is grid market power.
Right.
And with the benefit that the customer gets is we give them a contract with price certainty. We take the price risk. We might buy hedges associated with it. But a lot of it is market or grid power that they're getting. Because our hydro is really in many ways limited to those, you know, economic development and other customers that we serve. So a lot of that is already allocated.
Right, but it's limited. is statutorily limited, correct?
Correct. Yeah, you could work with that, right?
Right. So we should just look at that, yes, and just figure out whether it makes sense,
yeah,
to make some modifications to that. Any other questions from the committee?
No,
and this is our ranker, by the way. I think,
yes,
I failed.
Yes, and I thank you. It was a great meeting that we had this morning, and it was heartfelt, and I do mean that. And of course, I'm concerned, and all New Yorkers are concerned. Why should ratepayers pay for an investment that already are being made well by the private sector?
Well, I guess my answer would be that given the challenge we're facing here, we need all tools in the toolbox. Government can play a role. Nobody's suggesting that government be the only tool, but just given the enormity of what we're looking to achieve here, we think that NYPA and government can play an ancillary role, in the clean energy transition. So to the extent that costs that NYPA incurs are socialized over the state, you know, ratepayer base, it would really be no different, it seems to me, than any other energy policy.
And I thank you for that. You know, one thing that I'm concerned about, and we discussed it this morning also too, was can you give me an overall look at these battery stations that are going to be placed in areas, and are we obviously getting the community involved to let them know, and the cost, because I've been really, really researching the cost of these batteries for storage for wind and solar. My question again is, oh, the community, where are these stations going to be going, and how we're getting the community involved, and again, we spoke this morning also too, in the cost factor, who is going to be paying for this?
So if you're, there are different types of batteries, of course. We've got utility scale batteries that are, you know, larger in terms of megawatt output and all. Some of those would be located near we have one located near a transmission system in the North Country. We're doing a pilot in the North Country, 20 megawatt battery. They go through the same, you know, siting processes that other projects would go through. So, you know, all of the approvals that need to be made, that need to take place in order for a project to be sited would be also, you know, followed in this context. And I'm sure you're aware in a lot of discussions with FDNY about batteries in multifamily settings and so forth. So we're obviously working closely with entities like FDNY and others to make sure that batteries are, and there's also a lot of technological work going on in this context. I know for us, we have a demonstration project right outside our White Plains office. We're doing a partnership with a company called Cadenza, and that's a battery for densely populated urban areas that we're testing. And the technology is interesting. It's like a honeycomb. You know, the big threat with batteries is thermal runaway. Mm-hmm. And so this honeycomb technology basically isolates all the different, you know, cells within the battery. So if one catches on fire, it can't spread to any of the other ones. And we're testing that for deployment in the more urban areas. So there's a lot of work to be done. There's no question. It's I've read the stories, as you have, about the fires.
And again, you know, I'm very concerned because I do speak to our fire commissioners and everything like that. And they're going to be coming out because they're very concerned if an electric car goes on fire. And Senator, please don't put that car in your garage. Make sure it's outside, because if a car goes on fire, electric car goes on fire, you can't put it out. You have to let it burn to the ground. So again, it's not a fear factor. My question again is the location of these battery storage facilities. The communities will be notified where they're going or not?
The answer is yes, because it'd have to be, depending upon the size of the battery, obviously, you know, smaller house batteries wouldn't be, you know, part of the same kind of approval process that a larger battery would, but a battery of any kind of size is going to have to go through a permitting process where you're going to have to get sign off. Just like when we do a project, you know, with transmission line, we have to go through Article 7 process. We have to get all community engagement. We have to have town hall meetings. You know, so that kind of, certainly at the utility scale where we operate, would have that same kind of input.
Well, you own properties, obviously. So can you just go right on your property and put these battery storage units on there without letting the community know about that?
Not from the power authority's perspective, we would never do that. I mean, it'd depend on the size of the battery, and I can come back to you on what type of, you know, approvals are required based on sizing of batteries. But certainly, in the realm that we operate in, you know, we wouldn't just be, you know, dropping a battery in without having a community conversation around it.
Hey. I know. I don't want to hog up. I don't think my colleague over here. You have any questions?
Exactly.
Chairman, can I argue more?
No. And okay. Senator, thank you so much.
The chairman is already acting surprised that I had a question.
Yeah. Yes. Senator Wolchek.
Mr. President, first, thank you. Your staff has been tremendously helpful in helping us navigate some of the community changes through Smart Path across the North Country, which traverses a lot of my district. And also offering some perspective. They've been great neighbors, and I don't say that lightly. I'm not always complimentary of authorities or departments, but they've been certainly left a good impression in all the communities that they've been doing work. So please, from the staff that's on the ground to Joe or Steve here, they've been great partners. And
thank you.
We appreciate that. It doesn't go unnoticed that you've taken care of the people that you're supposed to. So last year you gave some testimony, brought it up recently. Is NYPA looking to get back into the renewable game? Do you think it fits the mission of the New York Power Authority to compete with private interests? And I don't mean that as a leading question. What is kind of your perspective as the leader of NYPA on the way forward and where you sort of position in this next phase?
Thank you. So I think it has to be understood that we're already in the renewable business, right? We have all these big governmental customers that I just had on the slide. We're doing customer-sited renewable projects for them. In fact, our largest customer is the prison system right now. Dox is our largest customer, where we have 30 megawatts of solar and storage on site. So we've been operating, because of our existing authority, where we can to lean in on renewables for customers. We did an aggregated 8-building rooftop solar on garages in White Plains, so all the garages have solar on the roof now. So the top floor, interestingly, although it didn't help this year, you don't have to plow the top floor anymore because there's a solar panel up on top. Didn't need it this year, at least so far. You know, we're doing community solar at JFK Airport, where the local disadvantaged community is benefiting from our solar project at JFK Airport. We have the largest rooftop solar in Manhattan on the Javits Center for the Javits Corporation. So we're playing a very substantial role in customer-sited renewables because that's where we're authorized to play right now. Given the challenge we're facing, to have NYPA be able to build projects here or there for one reason or another, maybe, you know, we typically partner with the private sector on most of the big projects we do. Interestingly, all four of the transmission projects that I list there are all with private sector partners. If doing renewable projects, big renewable projects, we'll want to work with a partner. There'll be smaller projects maybe the private sector doesn't want to do. Maybe NYPA steps in and does a project. Maybe there's a project on NYPA land. NYPA owns a lot of land. We're very uniquely positioned to utilize some of our state land to develop renewable projects. So I think it's just additive to what the industry is doing now. You know, my colleague Dorian Harris has testified a number of times now that if you look at the pipeline of what's in the queue, you know, we're at, if they all get built, again, projects will fall off, but, you know, as we sit here today, we're close to 65% toward our 2030 goal of 70% renewables if all that stuff gets built. And those projects will have to get built by those developers or others, but, you know, can NYPA be additive to that, you know, private sector work? I think so.
Okay. That answers my question.
Thanks, sir. Okay. Senator Mayhew?
Thank you. Thank you. Appreciate your questions and appreciate your attendance today. And, you know, your commentary and the presentation answered a lot of my questions. Along with the executive's proposal providing the authority with broad discretion in sitting renewable energy generating projects. Can you speak to what you see as far as how that is going to proceed? You did use the phrase here and there in your last comment, You know, how is, would there be local input, and, you know, what rules and regulations do we have to navigate?
Thank you. So I think it's important to understand that any project that we build will have to follow all the same requirements as any other development, no different than any other project. That's how we operate now, and that's how we'll be required to operate going forward. So in terms of community input, whether it's town hall meetings or citing approvals, or working with DEC on environmental issues, you know, working with the agriculture community on, you know, on issues around agricultural land, all that will continue to be part of the process here. So we're not looking in any way to shortcut or do any end arounds, any of that.
Can you speak to the future of nuclear when we talk about these smaller modular units? And what you envision there, and what you see as NYPA's potential role in that?
You and I discussed this previously. There's a lot of work being done in the SMR, small modular reactor space. I serve with the 26 largest public power CEOs on the large public power council, and I can tell you around the country there's a lot of interest in the deployment of small modular reactors. You know, I also sat on the Climate Action Council, where this was you know, discussed quite a bit. I'd have to say that, you know, we won't be a leader, I don't think, certainly at the Power Authority. I think that other states will potentially lead the way, and we'll see what comes out of that in the way of, you know, efficiencies, safety. But I don't think we certainly won't be leading on that at the Power Authority. But obviously, nuclear is a huge piece of where we sit today in terms of our clean energy. And I know you have the Fitzpatrick plant that in your district, and it's certainly a big part of you know, the clean energy portfolio, if you will, today. So
thank you.
Chairman, may I just do one more question,
absolutely.
Please? And I appreciate you all. What are your feelings on green hydrogen? I know we've been talking about that. I do have a tour that's going to be April 12th, which I know our chairman is going to be receiving an invite to go to Stony Brook Technology and to Brookhaven National Lab. We do have a project right now that we are using mixed fuels with hydrogen and natural gas combined. Do you see any future with that?
Yeah, I mean, I think hydrogen is certainly going to play a big role. The big question, I think, in the industry is what's the right role for hydrogen? Mm-hmm. We tested, as you know, I think in your district, at Brentwood,
yes.
A blending project,
yes.
At our Brentwood peaker, where we blended up to 40% hydrogen into an operating peaker plant, a gas-fired peaker plant, first in the nation to ever actually use hydrogen in a plant. We did that for the benefit of the industry, along with the Electric Power Research Institute. We have no plans to utilize hydrogen in any of our power plants, but we thought it was important learning, as did EPRI, for the industry. I think there's questions around whether hydrogen, you know, plays a role in the power sector. Most would say it may not be, that may not be the optimum use of it. There's issues around moving it around, transporting it, and so forth. There are big uses, from what I understand, big potential uses, your use cases in the heavy industrial area, like cement manufacturing, obviously in transportation, hydrogen fuel cells. So I think it's going to play a role, but I think it's too early to say what role it will play, certainly in the power sector.
Yeah, well, we need all kinds of clean energy sources, and, you know, this is something that I feel is very, very important for our future. Even California even has a waste energy facility that they're actually have hydrogen powered. So Brookhaven National Lab is right now proposing a hydrogen power plant on their site, which I'm very, very excited about. So again, I would love to have 50 sources of renewable energy, and, you know, we have to obviously look, because again, I'm still not getting the answer about the cost of these lithium batteries that's going to cost. I mean, I've been speaking to engineers and everything like that, and it's very costly, and I'm very concerned that our New Yorkers need to understand that it's going to be them that are going to be paying for this, the ratepayer. And that's what I got out of this morning, what we had a great conversation. So that's what I'm concerned about. We keep on talking about the federal government is going to be giving us money right now. We don't know if that's going to be the case. I hope, and again, Senator Schumer has been amazing bringing money back to New York State. But again, we can't rely on that, and I'm very, very concerned about that. So again, I know you said a couple times that, you know, the federal government, that's not a guarantee, is it?
It is. The money's already been allocated.
No,
they've already passed it.
Future monies.
What do you mean future money? The money we haven't gotten the present money.
Wait.
Let me just make a point of clarification. The federal government has put more money into decarbonization of the United States than any other program in the history of the United States, right? Like, there's money there. We haven't even drawn the money down yet. And so that money is current money, but it's also future money, right? Like, because we're not going to be able to even spend it all. If we got every dollar that we are probably due, we couldn't spend it all in the next year, right? And so that money is there. Hopefully the Republican House will in fact allocate more money in the next budget, and we'll have even more money down there. So if you're concerned about that, you should probably call your colleagues down in Congress and ask them to put forward another allocation in the budget that produces more federal dollars.
And Chairman, one thing that we came up with, a number of $270 billion, that's not going to even cover New York City.
But we're talking about
cover the whole state.
Well, we're talking about $270 billion over the course, first of all, 27 to 28 years, right? That's the first thing. Second thing, if you pass either my CCIA bill or my carbon pricing bill, you'll be taking steps towards raising that money in a way that makes sense. We also have, again, monies that are in play already to do some of that work. There's $1 billion in the Green Bank. There's $1 billion in NYSUN. There's money in Reggie. There's money in the Citizens Benefit Charge. So we're not starting from zero. There's money out there. There's more money coming. And again, the idea of CCIA and the idea of carbon pricing are both to do two things, both to raise money, but also to create an economic disincentive for carbon production, which is going to be as important as raising money for clean energy projects. And so you're right, it's going to be expensive, but it's also going to transform the economy. That money is not going to be going down a sieve. That money is going to be going into projects that are going to create full-time jobs at a living wage with benefits for people in your district and hopefully people in mine. And we'll be not just cleaning our ecology from carbon, but also creating a clean energy economy that will fuel the future.
And thank you, and we're all for renewable energy. And I know one senator got very upset that I say, but I'm very, very concerned about the cost of these battery stations. And not for anything, can we please do a study? I would love to do it, because I'm going to tell you something. We could do a study on how much it's going to cost to show how much it's going to cost for these batteries stations. And that's so important. And did we ever look into that? How much the cost of the battery stations, what it's going to cost for what we're looking to do?
The cost would depend on the type of battery. It runs the gamut from utility scale batteries, all the way down to, a wall-mounted Tesla battery in your garage. So it depends on the...
President Driscoll, in the context of battery storage programs that you're running through NYSERDA, let's talk about how is NYSERDA currently funded? Hmm. I'm sorry, not NYSERDA, I apologize, the Power Authority. How's the Power Authority currently funded?
We're funded exclusively through our power sales.
So it's off book?
Correct.
Right, so it's not money's not coming from the general fund?
Correct.
Okay. And so when you are doing a project, that is costed out from the context of the revenue that you're receiving?
Correct.
All right. So it's not costing extra dollars from taxpayers?
So it depends on the nature of the project. Again, a transmission project that we do, we go to FERC. We go to the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, and we get a rate of return from FERC, approved rate of return, that recovers our costs.
Right.
So those are highly regulated projects.
How is that different than a project that might be done by a utility?
No different.
That's right. Okay.
And on the generation side, you're either a merchant generator, right?
Right.
You're selling your power into the market every day, or you have a contracted off-taker. like these mostly renewable projects have a REC contract now,
right?
They get paid by NYSERDA.
What is, how important is battery storage in the context of both resiliency and reliability within sustainable development, sustainable energy systems?
Huge, huge. I mean, you know, that most of the, as you think about the future grid, most of the people that study this will tell you that it's going to be more decentralized than it is now. There's going to be a lot more on-site, you know, solar and storage. So battery technology is going to be key to those on-site solar storage, decentralized sort of, could be called a virtual power plant where you have a combination of solar and storage. You've got electric vehicles that have two-way power flows from the vehicles back into the building. You know, you've got energy efficiency, all these things coming together to provide additional resiliency. The more of those you have, the more resilient our entire system will be, and less dependent on the big grid.
Let me ask you another question. In the context of as we look at getting to the CLCPA goals, is the battery storage technology and capabilities that we see today, are those exactly the same as what we expect to see by even, let's say, 5 years from now?
I think it's going to be different. I think because one of the things that we're looking at is longer duration storage. So you're going to have options other than lithium ion batteries. Lithium ion presents some issues around minerals, right? Mineral availability and where you're getting the minerals from for those types of batteries. They also don't run typically as long. So there's a lot of work being done. And I mentioned earlier in one of our conversations around the zinc technology and the company that just moved to New York State from Vancouver to set up its U.S. headquarters in Kingston, 500 clean energy jobs. They're looking at using zinc as a longer duration storage. It's not limited to 4 or 8 hours like a lithium ion battery would. So I think there are going to be more areas like that where battery technology is going to be rapidly developing.
So we're seeing innovation in battery storage.
Correct.
And some of that innovation is actually creating full-time jobs at living wage with benefits here in the state of New York.
Correct.
Right. As we see these innovations come into play, are the price of battery storage going up or down?
I don't know the answer to that question. Okay. I'd have to research that for you. I guess I'd want to look into that and come back to you on whether, I don't know the cost of zinc versus battery, lithium ion battery technology. I know the benefits of the longer duration and the lack of dependency on minerals from other countries that are not presented by that technology. I'd have to ask somebody to kind of look at the numbers, but I'd be happy to come back to you on that,
yeah.
On that
please,
comparison.
Please do. Please do. I mean, I think that the issue around cost is a legitimate one, but I also think that it is something that we've calculated and something that's part of our analysis already. And not that our analysis is 100% complete, because I think there's things changing all the time kind of in this space.
Agreed.
Any other questions, comments by members of the committee? So, yes, you good?
Yeah, I thank you.
All right.
Thank you, Chair.
President Driscoll, any last parting words?
Just thank you for the opportunity to be here with you today. We got lucky with the storm last night, but I appreciate being here. And again, look forward to working with all of you. And thanks for the opportunity.
All right, thank you for being here. Thank you, members of the committee. Thank you for guests and people who are watching us. All my fans out. No. this has concluded this meeting of the Energy and Telecommunications Committee, and we hope to see you in a couple of weeks when we have our next meeting. Thank you.